Prior to Sunday, we'll have my second favorite service of the year. And that is when we gather in here on Good Friday and have our Good Friday candlelight Lord's Supper. It's a day that you and I just come, and as we think about Jesus dying on the cross for our sins, by candlelight, we take the bread and we take the juice, just remembering Him. So I would encourage you to set that aside on your calendar. Today is one of our pause days. I told you we'll pause in January, pause in February, pause in March, and then we'll have our Good Friday Lord's Supper where we'll pause once again. It's an opportunity for us just to stop and to think about what Jesus has said and our life based upon His truths, how many of them are being applied to our life. And today, we're going to begin with Jesus with the disciples in John chapter 16. Jesus has left the upper room. He has said to the disciples in John 14:31, "Come on, let's go." And so Jesus and the disciples, under the full moon of the Passover sky, have descended the upper room, and they're walking, and they're walking, and they're walking, and they're on their way to Calvary. And at some point on their way to Calvary, listen to what Jesus says in John chapter 16, verse 16. "In a little while, you will see me no more, and then after a little while, you will see me." It's rather confusing, isn't it? Read on. "Some of his disciples said to one another, 'What does this mean by saying, in a little while we'll see you no more, and then after a little while you'll see me? Because I'm going to the Father.' They kept asking, 'What does he mean by a little while? We don't understand what he's saying.'" Put yourself in the mindset of the disciples. The Bible says they kept asking, "What does he mean? We don't understand." So what was happening is the 11 disciples were whispering to one another, "What does he mean? I don't understand. I don't know. What's he talking about?" They simply didn't understand. Now remember, this is Thursday evening, early Friday morning. It's probably past midnight. Within 9 hours, Jesus will be on the cross. And they just can't comprehend what he has been telling them. Then skip down, if you will, to verse 25. "Though I have been speaking figuratively, a time is coming when I will no longer use this kind of language, but will tell you plainly about my Father." If you read the rest of John 16, if you read the prayer of John 17, if you read Acts chapter 1, verses 3 through 8, Jesus will dispense with the Proverbs, with this figurative language. He speaks plainly. But at this point, the disciples simply do not understand. If you go back to verse 16, they said, "In a little while you will see me no more." What does that mean, "in a little while you'll see me no more"? Well, think about it. If this is indeed Thursday evening, midnight, or past midnight, it will just be a little while, and Jesus will be arrested. He will be tried 6 times, and by 9 a.m, he's on a cross, and then he's in a tomb. Within 24 hours, they will not see Jesus again. They didn't understand it. Even though in Mark chapter 10, verses 33 to 34, Jesus said, "We're on our way to Jerusalem. And the chief priests and the teachers of the law are going to beat me. They're going to kill me. And I'm going to rise 3 days later." Even though he had told them, they simply didn't understand. And then he says this, "In a little while you'll see me no more, then after a little while, you'll see me." What's he talking about? Resurrection Sunday. They'll see him on Sunday. But they didn't understand. And I'm wondering this morning if maybe, just maybe, you're a little bit like the disciples. Maybe there is confusion in your life. Did you know that God says in 1 Corinthians 14:33, for God is not a God of disorder, but of peace? Or, the King James Version says, God is not the author of confusion. God doesn't want us to be confused. As a matter of fact, in John chapter 16, verse 13, here's what we read. But he, the Spirit of truth, when he comes, he'll guide you into all the truth. I want you to know that today, if you are a Christian, God is not the author of confusion in your life. He's not. What God desires for you is to move forward confidently in life because the Spirit of God teaches us the truth. But whether you walk out of this building and live a confused life or a confident life based on the truth depends on what you do with God's Word and the teaching of the Holy Spirit. It's about you. It's up to you whether you live with confidence or with confusion. But I can tell you this, and this is an absolute certainty. If you were to take your Bibles and look at John chapter 16, verse 19, here's what he says. Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about this. So he said to them, are you asking one another what I meant when I said, in a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me? Jesus knows what these disciples are thinking. The Greek verb there says Jesus saw or Jesus knew. Jesus knows exactly what you and I are thinking and doing. And that is why you should always remember Hebrews 4:13. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. So here's the truth. In just a moment, our deacons are going to hand you a piece of bread. I'm going to ask you to hold that bread until everybody has been served. But when you hold that piece of bread, I want you to know you can walk out of this building confused. You can be confused right now. Or you can turn to God and say, God, you have promised to guide me into the truth. I'm going to walk out of this building. I'm going to live the rest of my days with confidence in the truth. But that's up to you, and that's up to me, whether I live with confidence or confusion. But there is a certainty that is not up to you and is not up to me. The certainty is this, that God knows, that Jesus knows, just like he knew what those disciples were thinking, he knows what you're thinking, he knows what I'm thinking, he knows what you're doing, and what I'm doing. And so I'm going to ask you, when you get this piece of bread, just to hold it until we're all been served. And then I'm going to ask you to hold that piece of bread and pray and ask God, God, would you please remove from me my confusion and enable me to live the rest of my days with confidence in your truth. Thank you. Says that the very night we're talking about, Thursday evening, Jesus said to his disciples, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The Apostle Paul gave us a caution that I would like to read to all of us. The caution is this: "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord." Then he explains what an unworthy manner is. A man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread and drinks of the cup. So an unworthy manner is this, that I choose not to examine myself. I don't look at my life. I don't confess my sins. Then he says in verse 29, "For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing, discerning, or discriminating the body of the Lord, eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep." So Jesus is saying, if you take the bread and the juice, you don't think about what you're doing, if you're not recognizing, discriminating the body of Jesus, then we become just like the scribes and the Pharisees who allowed Jesus to be crucified. They're not recognizing that Jesus is somebody special, the Christ, the Messiah. So when we partake of the Lord's Supper, it is first of all only for Christians. And so if you're not a Christian, you should just not take the bread and the juice. But if you are a Christian and you're not willing to examine your life, you're not willing to confess your sins, if you're not willing to think, this is an awesome opportunity I have to think that this is the symbol of the body of Jesus. But this is just another thing that you're doing. Set it aside. Because the Bible says that God brings judgment on those of us who don't discriminate with the body of Jesus. So here's what we're told. "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. And Father, I thank you not only do I thank you, that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. But I'm thankful, Father, that we are about to learn a truth that could revolutionize not only our lives, but our church. If we would be willing today to ask you for understanding, Lord, if we would move forward with clarity. And so while I thank you for Jesus, I also want to thank you for the truth that we are about to learn. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Twice on this occasion, Jesus tells the disciples, I tell you the truth. And I want you to look with me at this because this is so important. This will revolutionize your life. Starting in verse 20. I tell you the truth. You will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that the child is born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice. And no one will take away your joy. I want you to really think about it, because this is where we need to understand. Jesus says, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. The disciples, within a few hours, are going to be weeping and mourning. Jesus was on the cross. He was crucified, he was put in the tomb, and they are depressed, they are crushed, they are weeping. All of their hopes were gone. Maybe that's you. But while they are weeping, what does the Bible say the world is doing? Look at it, class. Look at it very closely. I tell you the truth. While you weep and mourn, the world what, class? What's the next word? Rejoices. Rejoices. You need to understand. This verse tells us why we are so different than the world. What were the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the teachers of the law doing? They were happy. They were excited. Jesus, the thorn in their flesh, was gone. And I want to tell you something. You and I weep and mourn over the 59 million dead babies. What does the world do? It rejoices that a woman has the right to choose. This is where the distinction between the church and the world comes in. While you're mourning, they are rejoicing. Makes you understand why the world can be happy in your sadness. But now here is the greatest truth that you will learn today. I tell you the truth. You will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. That's what it says. Your grief will turn to joy. It does not say your grief will be followed by joy. That's not what it says. It says your grief will turn to joy. And here's what that means. That which is causing you grief, that which is causing you sorrow, that which is causing you despair, that very thing will turn to joy. How is that possible? If you were to take your Bibles and go to Galatians 6:14, our theme verse for last year, here's what you would read. May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. What was going to make these disciples weep and mourn? It was the cross. The cross was taking Jesus. The cross was crucifying their Savior. The cross was taking that person that they had placed all their hopes in. The cross had taken them. But now the Apostle Paul says, I'm rejoicing in the cross. I'm boasting in the cross. The very thing that caused grief now brings joy into their life. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. God is capable of taking your sorrow, your grief, your despair, whatever bad experience there is, God is capable of turning that into His good and your joy. God can do that. I can't. You can't. God can. Now, one of my favorite stories in the Bible is the story of Mark 9, where the disciples are brought a young boy who is demon-possessed. Let me read the story to you. You know, it's going to take some time, and I thought about this, but I would rather you hear the story in its entirety and get out a few minutes late. Listen to what the Bible says. The disciples brought this young boy who was demon-possessed. He was throwing the boy into the fire and into the water. The father is in despair, so he brings the boy to the disciples. Picking up the story in Mark 9, verse 18, he says, but the disciples could not do anything. Oh, unbelieving generation, Jesus replied. How long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. Would you say that with me? Bring the boy to me. Say it again. Bring the boy to me. Say it again. Bring the boy to me. I'm here to say to you, God can take that grief. He can turn it into joy. But we have to bring the grief to Jesus. We have to bring it to Him. Now listen. So they brought Him. And when the Spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and he rolled around foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, how long has it been like this? From childhood, he answered. It is often thrown him into the fire or water to kill him. If you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for him who believes. Is that true? Amen. Everything is possible for him who believes. Is it even possible to take that grief and have it become a joy? Is it?
Amen.
Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene. He rebuked the evil spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you. Come out of him. Never enter him again. The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently. He came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet and he stood up. And Jesus had gone indoors. His disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, this kind can come out only by prayer. What I'm here to say to you is this. If you believe the Bible, and if you believe that the Holy Spirit inspired the Bible, and if you believe that the Bible is written word by word as God wanted it, then when you read John chapter 16, verse 20, it says, but your grief will become joy. It does not say joy will follow. It says that He will take that which is grieving you, despairing you, and turn that into joy. Only God can do that. So in a few moments, when our deacons hand you this juice, I'm going to ask you, God, God, will you take my grief and will you turn it to joy? And if you lack faith, say, oh God, give me faith. That's what the Father prayed. Help my unbelief. But there's something else you must see. Not only does God promise joy, and He does, but He promises complete joy. Look at verse 23. In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. I tell you the truth. My Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive it, and your joy will be, what's the next word? Complete. Full. Let's say it. Complete joy. Say it. Complete joy. He's not promising you a quarter joy. He's not promising you a half joy. He's promising you complete joy, full joy. Do we believe the Bible? Do we believe the Bible? He's promising complete joy. How can I have complete joy? Here's what he says in verse 26. In that day, you will ask in my name. I'm not saying that I'll ask the Father on your behalf. No. The Father Himself loves you because you have loved me and you have believed that I came from God. Here's what Jesus is saying. In that day, after the death, after the burial, after the resurrection, after the ascension, the Holy Spirit comes. He says, in that day, you will ask in my name. Hitherto you haven't done that. They haven't. As the disciples prayed, they never said, dear God, help me with this in Jesus' name. Jesus was standing right there. They never did that. But he says, a new day is coming. And the new day is this. You will ask in my name. And the Father will give you what you ask. And you will have complete joy. He's talking about prevailing prayer. The power that you have as a believer in Jesus Christ to touch the throne of Almighty God in heaven and have complete joy. How does that happen? Jesus says, I'm not going to ask the Father on your behalf. It sounds like Jesus is being mean-spirited, doesn't it? That's not what he's saying at all. He's saying, I'm not going to ask the Father. I'm not going to be here. I'm going to be in heaven. But you can ask the Father. And by the way, says Jesus, the Father loves you because you love me. Think of it. What God is saying to you and me today, I can take your grief and turn it to joy. But I can also teach you how to prevail in prayer so that you will have answers to prayer and you won't just have joy. You will have complete joy. The key, though, is we have to learn how to pray in Jesus' name. And praying in Jesus' name doesn't mean that we tack a little ditty onto the end of our prayers. What it means is this. When I pray in Jesus' name, I'm praying because I'm a Christian. I'm going to God because I'm a Christian. I'm going and I'm praying that which Jesus would pray. It is in His character. In other words, I'm praying according to God's will and God's word. And I'm praying, not based on my merits. Dear God, do this for me, I'm a pastor. No, I have no merits. My only merit is I'm going to God because of Jesus, who died on the cross for my sin. And Jesus says, you will be able to prevail in prayer and have complete joy. It was on this night, this very night, that Jesus said to his disciples, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. I want you to remember the caution that I just shared with you a few moments ago. And then I'm going to ask you, while you're holding this juice, would you ask the Lord, God, would you turn my grief into joy? God, Would you give me faith to believe that you can turn my grief into joy? God, just like the Father brought his Son to you, Father, I'm bringing my grief to you. Father, would you teach me how to pray and prevail in prayer so I have complete joy? You see, I am such a simple person. I believe that Jesus died on the cross, not just for my sins so that I could go to heaven, but so that my grief would turn to joy, and I would learn how to pray prevailing prayers and have complete joy. I hope you believe that. Just as much as I believe that, I believe grief can turn to joy. And I believe that I can have complete joy in learning how to prevail in prayer. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, this is a rather challenging passage of Scripture. And the reason it's challenging is because turning grief to joy is not something that normally happens. And so, Lord, I would confess that I was so convicted by this passage of Scripture, because so often I have not taken my grief and given it to you. I've nourished it. I've nurtured it. I've wallowed in it. But I haven't given it to you. And therefore, it didn't turn to joy. And I can also say that so much of my prayers is, give me, give me, give me, give me. And I have not prevailed in prayer, so that I have not had complete joy. Dear God Almighty, these are promises, and I thank you for them. And I pray, God, that you would challenge each of us as a church understand what you're saying, because the disciples didn't. Thank you for Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Let me just share a few closing connection points with you. And the first is this. You may not understand. You may have a doubt, a question. The Bible says, ask of God in James 1:5, and he'll give you understanding. When you look at verse 20, he says your grief will turn to joy or become joy. That's a truth. And so your truth, your joy can be, your grief can become joy. But that means that we have to turn to Jesus in the pages of the Bible. It means we have to turn to the Holy Spirit, the teacher of truth. It means we have to turn away from our sins and our grief can become joy. But it also means this, and this is a very, this, the Lord just convicted me on this. It also means that my problems, or our problems, have got to be given to God. The Father brought the problem to Jesus. And a lot of times we don't bring them to Jesus. In order for Jesus to turn the grief to joy, he had to go to Calvary, didn't he? And you know, Jesus told us that we have to pick up our cross and follow him. But too often, we're not willing to die. We want the joy. We want the complete joy. But so often, we're not willing to pick up our cross and die for ourselves. Jesus did, and we will have to as well. He promises joy. And joy is the fruit of the Spirit. Now, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. The joy also comes when Jesus turns the grief to joy. And complete joy comes when we learn how to prevail in prayer. Prevailing prayer means I'm praying according to God's Word, and I'm praying in His will. If we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, and we know that we have the petitions and the desire of Him. That's prevailing prayer. You might not feel loved today, but verse 27 says, the Father Himself loves you because you have loved me. Isn't that a wonderful truth? If you love Jesus today, then God the Father loves you. You know, our church will become debt-free this year. That moves us into a new phase of our church. And Jesus promised in John 15 that the Father will make known His plans to us. So I want to encourage you to ask God, what is your plan for our church? We know that the purpose will be to bear fruit, to glorify Him. We know that. So how does all of that work in the next phase of our church? Ask Him, He'll reveal it. Before we leave today, I'm asking you, Do you have 100% certainty of your position in Christ? The Bible says these things are written so that you might know that you have eternal life. Are you 100% certain? If not, we're going to stand and sing a hymn of invitation in about 45 seconds. And then invite you to come. And to take my hand and say, Pastor, I need to know for certain I'm a Christian. You see, you're about to make a choice. Where will you spend your eternal days? Jesus said it. As many as received Him, to them He gave the authority to become a child of God. I would be glad to help you with that. And if you don't feel comfortable walking down an aisle, then take that tarot section and say, Pastor, I've got a doubt if I'm a Christian. But then I would ask you to consider this as well. How are you going to live the rest of your earthly days? If you begin to boil down and say what Jesus said starting in John 13, He said, I'm going to tell you how to be happy, how to have peace, how to have purpose, and how to glorify Him. That means that I can walk out of here today living that type of life. But He also says, you can prevail in prayer. Is that what you want? He teaches us how. He offers us to be a human channel of the Holy Spirit. But He also says, you will be persecuted. You know, today, in two different school systems, we have two teenagers that are being persecuted. Did you know that? Two teenagers in our church, in two different school systems, are being persecuted. Do you know why they're being persecuted? Because they're living for Jesus. Because they're attending devotions. And as a result, they're being persecuted. So we have to ask ourselves as adults, are we willing to be persecuted, or do we want to be popular and forego persecution? And then the last question is this. Jesus said in John 16:1, I hope you won't go astray. But you might be going astray today. And if so, wouldn't today be the perfect day to say, I want to repent, I want to turn around and go the other way? That's what repentance is. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for Jesus. And thank you for the gift of eternal life. Now, Father, I just want to thank you that as I study this passage of Scripture, I want to thank you for the conviction of the Holy Spirit that came upon me, that I was not turning my grief over to you. And so therefore, I didn't have joy. I want to thank you for challenging me that my prayer life, instead of being a laundry list of givings, needs to change so that it's according to your word and your will, so that I would have complete joy. Father, I believe in the promise of eternal life, and I hope that if there's someone here who isn't a Christian or is uncertain of their Christianity, that they would come and they would say, I want to be a Christian. But you know, Father, I believe that many of us here are Christians, but we're not happy. We don't have peace. Our grief has not turned into joy. We don't have complete joy in prevailing prayer. And maybe even some of us choosing to go astray. Father, what a day of rejoicing this would be if today we would turn to you and surrender our life, our grief, our sorrows to you. This has been a challenging message, somewhat uncomfortable, I'm sure, for many of us, but it's the truth. I pray that we will understand it and follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand? He leadeth me. You come as He leads.